الحمد لله الذي أنزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا، والصلاة والسلام على خير خلق ونور عرش أفضل الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبنا وسيدنا وسندنا وشفيعنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين، أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب المجيد وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه، فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وما بدلوا تبديلا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات على محمد وآل محمد. I begin in Allah's name, the Beneficent, the Merciful, and all praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us the opportunity to represent Him and to test us on this earth with trials and tribulations. And with His mercy, that while we are tested, He makes our backs strong. For Allah says in the Quran, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. We do not put a burden on a self except that what it can handle. And you and I get stronger when we are tried and tested. It's just like when somebody goes to the gym and works out. If they are persistent in it and they maintain a consistent standard, then the human body responds by strengthening itself and giving the fruits of its labor. Just like when we work hard in a proactive way and we bring about good results, we benefit from its results in this world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised us that the results will also be for the hereafter, if we appreciate and acknowledge the very purpose and mission by which we were created for. And therefore, it's essential for us to always live a life, to constantly come to firmness with this reality, that we have been chosen, we have been placed on this earth for a temporary period of time. Everything that we play with on this earth, the material entities, will remain behind. There is no one that has ever taken it with them. Impossible. There is no evidence whatsoever, 100% evidence, that we leave everything behind. Allah says, وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتِ خَيْرٌ أَنَّ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ أَمَلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the only thing that is left are your deeds. And it is essential for us to realize that as a human race, when we are placed on this earth to be tested, our trial is not in how much we acquire, or how strong we become physically, or how beautiful we maintain ourselves aesthetically. But rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to test us upon our deeds. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورُ. He created death and life to test which of you is best in deeds, because that's the objective of life. Everything else is secondary. Everything. Our material acquisitions, our beauty, our strength, our gender, everything is secondary. The only primary objective that is under trial is our behavior, our akhlaq, our vision. That is why the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam has stated, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمُ الْأَخْلَاقِ. Indeed, I have been sent to perfect your moral traits. And the Holy Prophet is the best role model of the moral traits, and I've been discussing this the past few nights, the importance of role models, and that you and I need to focus on prophetic missions and Ahlul Bayt and the Quran as our only guiding light in this world to succeed in this reality. And the reality is to be upright. كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. You are the best. Who are you? You promote good, you forbid evil, you believe in God. This is what Allah's objective is in the Quran, and it's consistent. The Quran consistently maintains this pathway, the upholdingness. فَأَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا لَا تَبْدِيلَ لِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ ذَلِكَ الدِّينُ الْقَيِّمُ. Maintain your faces upright. فَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا. Straight, upright. Allah says, be upright means what? It means believe in Allah. Why? because my template of morality is from Allah. Allah is the giver of all good. الَّذِي أَحْسَنَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَ Allah says in the Quran. He creates everything good. And He is the originator of all good. فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنَ الْخَالِقِينَ Blessed is He who creates everything good. And if Allah is outside of our vision, or if we are blurred, then our morality will be blurred. We may think we're doing good, but we will be doing bad. Like ISIS thinks they're doing good. You see? George Bush thought he was doing good by sending an army and putting his democracy, his brand of democracy, while going to church, thinking that he is upholding the mission. But their tawheed is blurred. Their vision of Allah is blurred. For Allah does not allow such wretchedness to bring goodness. As our Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi wasalam stated, you can never achieve virtue through vice. Never. Otherwise, the Holy Prophet ﷺ would have taken the keys of the Kaaba when Abu Sufyan and his cronies offered it to him in the beginning stages of the completion of the religion of Islam. But he refused. He said, if you put the moon in one hand and the sun in the other, I will not stop promoting and preaching and living. La ilaha illallah. Right? مَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ أَن يَتَّخِذَ وَلَدًا سُبْحَانَهُ إِذَا قَضَى أَمْرًا فَإِنَّمَا يَقُولُ لَوْ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ This is the foundation of all moralities. If Allah is removed from the picture, then our morality is blurred. Anybody who doesn't understand Tawheed, they may project a kind heart. They may project a clear intention of being good. And they may sincerely want to do good. But if their clarity in Tawheed is not constantly struggled towards, meaning that you and I have to constantly reflect. وَذَكَّرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا Allah says. Whoever, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا Indeed, O Messenger, for you, Allah is saying to us, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ For you, O لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ In the Prophet, أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا Best role model, Quran says. But who are the ones? It says, لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهِ For the one who has the desire to return to Allah. Why? Return in what way? Death? No. No, no. You could live 10,000 years on this earth. That's not Yarjullah. Yarjullah here means you are so close to Allah that everything you do is Allah. For Allah, in other words. Everything. We never lie, therefore. Look, if a person is very focused on Tawheed, logically, let's be logical here. If a person is very focused in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they understand Tawheed, do you think such a person will ever lie, will ever cheat, will ever be stingy, will ever be wretched, will ever be jealous? Or they will be giving, forgiving, loving, sharing, caring? What's the quality of a person who knows Tawheed? Tell me. All those people who do wretched things, 100% their Tawheed is off base. That is why when you examine the prophets and imams, they were constantly talking Tawheed. Imam Hussain alayhi salam in Karbala is constantly talking Tawheed. Talking about Allah, talking to Allah. While they're hearing it, he's talking to Allah. Telling them, you people have missed your Tawheed. Why Salah in Karbala? Imams came, Imam Hussain says, I am going not to hold the Khilafah. I don't want this Khilafah. It has already been ordained upon us that Allah has chosen us. This is a decree of Allah. There's nothing the human society can sit around and vote or choose a khalifa. How absurd is the idea? When were prophets chosen? Who chose prophets? Did you ever choose prophets? Did you ever gather and have a shura, council, and choose a prophet? Even a prophet who came to a family was not chosen by the family. So then how can the representatives of Allah be chosen by people? Allah chooses them. Allah said, مَنْدَ اللَّهُ يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِي Who can intercede on behalf of Allah except by His permission? يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ They know nothing of themselves. Allah says, I give them knowledge. See, I know what is in front of them, what is behind them. I protect them. Imam Hussain alayhi salam in Karbala is reciting as the messenger. Clarifying Tawheed, the minute your Tawheed becomes clear, the swords will come down. Because the religion of Islam will rise. And what is the religion of Islam made up of? Salama. The root word is Salama. Somebody asks you, what does Islam mean? Tell them it means peace. Submission. No religion is named so appropriately but Islam. All religions are named after persons and objects. Islam is the only religion that's a verb and a noun that's named appropriately, and it is only evidential that no one can name it but the one who sent it, which is none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So our vision should be clear. Allah said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. The messenger is the best example. لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهِ. One who wants to return to Allah. وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. They keep the day of judgment clear in their visions. Many of us who do wrong in our societies have forgotten the day of judgment. We don't keep it as a central principle of our lives. We keep it peripheral when it's reminded of us. Yeah, we do wake up when we are reminded. That's why Allah says, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّ فَعَتِ الذِّكْرَ. Remind them. Reminding them is beneficial. So ذَكَّرُ مَنْ يَخْشَى. Who will listen? The one whose heart is ready to listen. Not the one whose heart is hard. And Imam Ali alayhi salam says, مَا جَفَّتِ الدَّمُ إِلَّا لِقَسْوَةِ الْقُلُوبِ وَمَا قَسَتِ الْقُلُوبِ إِلَّا لِكَثْرَةِ الذُّنُوبِ. Tears don't come out. See, tears here, the reflection of a soft heart, one who is cognizant of his duty, one who is afraid of the day of judgment, one who is fearful of their duties in life, one who makes sure that they are upright and they don't steal and cheat and lie and perpetuate jealousy and harm on others. You see? Iman says, مَا جَفَّتِ الدَّمُ إِلَّا لِقَسْوَةِ الْقُلُوبِ. Tears don't come until hearts become hard. وَمَا قَسَتِ الْقُلُوبِ إِلَّا لِكَثَّةِ الذُّنُوبِ. And hearts don't get hard unless they're filled with sin. Imam Ali alayhi salam says this in Nahjul Balagha. وَمَا قَسَتِ الْقُلُوبِ إِلَّا لِكَثْرَةِ الذُّنُوبِ. كَثْرَةِ الذُّنُوبِ is what? Excessive sin, evil, forgetting Allah, forgetting the Day of Judgment. When we forget, then we become reckless. We become impulsive and compulsive. And we become a dangerous human race, human being, that starts now to be voracious and we start eating each other. We become an anarchistic society that just violates all laws. And laws are made, those kinds of laws are made to make the halal haram and haram halal. And the messenger stated in hadith, he said, there will come a time, haram will be halal and halal will be haram. And the companion says, وَبِذَلِكَ really? He said, yes, even more. He says, men will be like women, women will be like men. He says, the situation will be so bad that for you to worship Islam will be like holding charcoal in your hand, red charcoal in your hand. So difficult. Why? Did Allah make it this way? No. No, no. We made it this way. Our negligence and our oblivious attitude, oblivious meaning recklessness, not caring, living like a herd of cattle, not paying heed to this famous statement of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, Hal min nasirin yansuruna. Who's there to help me? We say labbaik ya Hussein. Do we? Inshallah we do. Millions of people say labbaik. But what's the core of this labbaik? Tonight, the night of Rabaeen, I send our condolences to the world. Our condolences to the whole world for a tragic event, and yet it is laced with victory. Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. Victory. And it will continue to grow. See? إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا. Mankind will enter the religion of Allah in armies. I believe these verses is because of Imam Hussein alayhi salam in Karbala. Why he exemplified when the Prophet says, Hussein minni wa ana min al Hussein. Hussein is from me, and I am from Hussein. Meaning the Holy Prophet established Islam, and the perpetuity of Islam, and the protection of Islam was Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. Salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. My respected doctor, my uncles, my brothers and sisters in Islam, salam alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Tonight is a sad night. There's a big message I'd like to send. There's much to say. I want to read the khutbah of Imam Zain al-Abidin, profound. The real victory of Imam Hussain alayhi salam after Karbala was to go to the belly of the beast while Yazid is sitting on his pulpit, drunk, that Imam Zain al-Abidin is now on the pulpit, reciting the most eloquent khutbah. What is the eloquence about? What is this khutbah about? Imam is simply establishing his authority. So when go back in history and you will see that Allah says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. And Allah said to the angels, I will place on this earth my khalifa. Angels are asking, how? How? When this community will kill each other, they will shed blood, they will disobey you, Allah. نَحْنُ نُصَبِّ بِحَمْدِ. Right? We do tasbih of you. We submit to you. How come this one we should bow to? He says, إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُ. I know that which you don't know. Allah says to the angels. And the angels say, okay, we agree. What is this quality? Subhanallah. There is one hadith that's really amazing, that really strikes me deep, deep, deep. When the Holy Prophet was commanded to leave Mecca, Hijrah. Hijrah becomes obligatory, wajib, when your life is on the line. It becomes obligatory to leave. So the messenger is leaving, but he needed somebody to sleep in his bed. You know, people say there were people who were with him in the cave. And how important is that? I said, I want you to reflect. How important is the one who slept in his bed with daggers right at the edge of the blanket? How important was that? And the Prophet comes to Imam Ali alayhi salam and says, I have to do hijrah, but you must remain behind because you are me. See, anfusana wa anfusakum. Yourselves, myself. I only leave myself. Imam Ali alayhi salam is the self of the Prophet. Nobody could return the amana, the jewels, the wealth of the people of Mecca. And this is a lesson for us. The perfection when Allah said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. That the Prophet is your best role model. Here's an example. That while these kuffar are hitting him, throwing stones at him, ready to stab him, he has the wealth. And he can argue to say, yes, you are my enemy, and I'm the Prophet of God, I will embezzle this money. Even in such peril and such tribulations, you find the Prophet says, amana must be returned. يُوفُونَ بِالنَّذْرِ وَيَخَافُونَ يَوْمًا كَانَ شَرُّهُ مُسْتَطِيرًا. They maintain their promises, and they are afraid of that day. This is how the Holy Prophets are. This is how the Imams are. We cry for them in Arba'een, we cry for them in Ashura. We better stand up to these principles, otherwise our love is not equivalent. Inshallah it will be. We have lost. 10 million people are going to Karbala as we speak. 10 million people, many more. Right? The Abbasids tried to kill people. They used to behead them. They used to dismember their body parts if you even approach the haram of Hussein alayhi salam. Why? The very people who took the Khilafah under the claim of taking revenge on the Banu Umayyah were the very people who realized that the essence, the maintenance of the deen of Islam is in the love of Hussein ibn Ali alayhi salam. In this what we call Azadari of Hussein ibn Ali alayhi salam. Salat ala Muhammad wa al-Muhammad. Millions of people go. The maintenance is there. Our imams are maintaining it. But what is this maintenance about? If not the qualities, highest moral qualities. We can talk till judgment day. We will not exhaust. وَلَوْ أَنَّمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٍ وَالْبَحْرِ يَمُدُّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ السَّبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ. If you took all the trees on earth, Allah says, you made them pens, and you took the seas and made them ink, and you added seven more seas, Allah says, you will not exhaust the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who are the Ahlul Bayt, if not the walking, talking Sha'ir Allah, signs of God? Who are they? This is why their dhikr is so important. Those who tell us, don't mention Ahlul Bayt, don't. I say, tell me where in the Quran will I ever say that? The entire Quran is a dhikr of the representatives of Allah. Dhikr rahmati rabbika abdahu Zakariya. The dhikr of Zakariya. How is dhikr? Allah says, wadhkur fil kitabi Musa. Remind them in the book about Musa. Why dhikr? If not dhikr, where do I go? What do you think people are doing in Hollywood? They're doing dhikr too. Bollywood is dhikr. People who go to Bollywood movies and they watch three hours of nonsense many times. I see people coming out of these Indian shops, carrying 4 or 5 of them. I says, okay, that's like 18 hours of absolute nonsense. I mean, I'm sure they learned something in it, but you know, right? وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهُوَ الْحَدِيثِ لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ وَيَتَّخِذَهَا هُزُوًا. Among mankind, they create frivolous talk. But when I look at this guy carrying all these cassettes, I say, why is he carrying this? He wants to do dhikr. That's what he wants. He wants to do dhikr. Why, he's got lots of pan in his mouth, wants to do dhikr. Not generalizing it stereotypically, not to put down people who eat pan, but my point I'm saying is, dhikr, no problem, do your dhikr. Well, what the difference between dhikr of this and dhikr of that? Huh? What have you achieved with that? People who go to sports and they have statistics. Such a team won such and such. I said, good, very nice. What did he do for you? Oh, I'm an expert. Statistician, mashallah. And what did you achieve in life? Statistics? Maybe I can be a sports, you know, talk show host. And I'll just blab away at the statistics. Which is the next team? Then when you ask the people, what about that tennis player, you know, Bjorn Borg? Huh? Who's he? Borg? Like, is the tennis player called Borg? Yeah, did you know he was like the great one? Oh. Allah said, look how they vanish. And all the statisticians of Borg, what did he achieve? Nothing. How about this achievement? This achievement, the achievement of the remembrance of dhikr in this way, you will notice that you and I cannot avoid to do dhikr of people's lives. As I mentioned 2 nights ago. You can't avoid it. Why is Hollywood such a bustling business? We are inquisitive. We want to know how do people live. So what happened? So how did it happen? You know, whenever I watch a movie, I always look for the moral lesson behind it. Otherwise, I get bored. If it's a good movie, if there's a moral lesson, I like it. If there's an immoral lesson, I fast forward. It's okay, this is nonsense. I'm going to choose my morality. Why? Because I don't have time. Life is too short to waste time with stupidity. Time is against me. You know? Allah said, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Except those who believe. They enjoin on each other. Haqq. Justice. Equity. What does that mean? We talk positive. We don't allow negative talk. We don't allow. This is dhikr. When I'm talking about dhikr of Allah, purifying the tawheed, this is the practical. When we go to Karbala and we remember Imam Hussein alayhi salam, and when we examine leadership and when we understand the structure of Allah, all of this is dhikr in the purity of tawheed. There's nothing that is fragmented. Continuous flow in the deen of Allah, it's a mesh of information. One point to the next. And Allah says, embed yourself in it. You see? So Allah says, وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Who are they? The ones who believe in the Day of Judgment and they do dhikr of Allah, kathira. Dhikr kathira doesn't mean take tasbih, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar all the time. That's okay. But when you say Allahu Akbar, what do you mean by Allahu Akbar? There are people having tasbih saying Allahu Akbar and they're commanding death of people. Unfairly. Not that kind of Allahu Akbar. Not the Umar Saad kind of Allahu Akbar. The one who knew Quran. While he threw the first arrow in Karbala and said, let them all know, Ana. Umar ibn Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, I am the first one to start. Shame on you. أَرَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ. Have you not seen those who belie the religion? أَرَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ. And they are the ones who are the enemies of orphans. What did they do to the orphans of Banu Hashim in Karbala? What did they do to Sukina, Ruqayya? Huh? The little children that they pulled, even their jewelry, and they tore their earlobes. فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ وَلَا يَحُضُّ عَلَىٰ طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. And they hold back food to the poor. Allah says, you see this? This is happening. People are wrong. Our dhikr is the opposite. We have the community. We have the finest templates on earth. As much as these institutions are making billions of dollars, billions, I look at them and I say, you've got nothing. You may have amassed wealth, but you don't have the spirit. You haven't hit the target. Target is this, the Quran. I promise us,
I stand to be challenged, even in academia, even in universities, I speak about this. I say, I stand to be challenged. Find me a better moral argument than the role models that God has sent of the highest character, and nobody has got it but Islam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Why? Leadership. Leadership. That the beginning of Allah's mission on earth for mankind, Allah says, I'm going to place a Khalifa on this earth. Angels are asking why. And then, how did the angels realize? Subhanallah. Then one example I give, that when the Holy Prophet was leaving Mecca, Imam Ali slept in his bed. Historians say that Allah sent a message to Jibreel and Mikael. He said, Jibreel and Mikael, I make you brothers. Which of you will give their life for the other? And they hesitated. Though they're infallible, they hesitated. History says they hesitated. To give yourself your life? See? Allah SWT says, مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا. Among men are those who gladly keep their promise. They say, Imam Ali alayhi salam, when he was asked by the Holy Prophet, will you sleep in my bed? Imam smiled. He said, Wallah, for the first time I prayed, although he prayed all the time. He said, I prayed 2 rak'ah salat al-shukr. And I prayed to Allah, thanking him to give me the opportunity to be in the bed of the Prophet and to give my soul for him.
Nare Haydari!
Ya Ali!
So that's why angels bowed to us. That's why Allah says, Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun. I know that which you don't know. Leadership. You examine every institution in the world today. Let's go in the sports world. You can have Michael Jordan, LeBron James, take all the basketball gurus, top, put them in a team. You don't have a coach, probably not going to win. So why? Got the best basketball players put together. Without a coach, you just don't have success. Look, you have the finest players. Put them together. Let them play. No, you need a coach. Find me a corporation that doesn't have a leader. It's all about leadership. Today, all this hell happening in the world today is because of bad leadership. The Umayyad kind of leadership. The ones that do bad are the Umayyad kind of leadership. That is why I want to stress, you and I tonight, when we remember Arba'een, and I'll tell you the story behind Arba'een, inshallah, is that this reiteration, when we cry, and all these beautiful nawhas are recited, and we cry with the reflection to say, I am replying to your Imam. He says, Hal min nasrin yansuruna. Who among mankind is there to help me? Imam is saying, 14 centuries later, you are in America. Are you helping me? Are you standing firm with my message? You come and cry, but do you represent me with honesty? Do you represent me with truth? Do you represent me with integrity? You know why our children today are lost, many of them? Honestly, because we give them mixed messages. We come to the masjid centers, we're very pious. We leave, we lie, we cheat, we do nasty business just to amass our wealth. And the children see that. We see parents dropping their kids off to madrasa. Son, that is very good for you, you need to learn Quran. And the son says, Baba, what about you? I'm too old. Too old. When did it become too old? When Malakul Maut meets us, you'll tell him 1 second? He'll say, no time. It will catch you so fast, you won't know what hit you. What time? Now the child, as he's leaving the car, says, well, I know my father knows this is important, but it's not that important. Because if it was, he'd be with me. So this contradiction of lifestyle is what leads to apathy in our children. Double standards. When we live double standard lives, we confuse our next generations. We become bad role models. We talk about the integrity of Rasulullah. 40 years, he remained silent as a prophet. Why 40 years? Isa declared his prophet at birth. قال إني عبد الله أتاني الكتاب وجعلني نبيا وجعلني مباركا إنما كنت. I am the servant of God. I've been made a prophet. And I've been given the scripture, Injil. Why the prophet 40? Because when you examine human behavior, you will notice nothing is more profound, more than even speaking in the cradle, than integrity and consistency. People are willing to be beaten, abused, because they believe in integrity. And the messenger stood on Jabal Abu Qubais and he said, if I tell you, Ana Muhammad, if I tell you there is a caravan behind this mountain, will you believe me? Who did he call? The Meccans, the idol worshippers, the heathens of the time. Heathens. These people were wretched. They had no akhlaq. They used to walk naked. That's how wretched they were. They used to slice each other and kill each other like nothing. They were wild, wilder than the West. And the Prophet is asking them, if I tell you there is a caravan behind this mountain, will you believe me? They said, Anta sadiqul amin. You are truthful, honest. He says, then I tell you there is no God but one, and I am his messenger. Subhanallah. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So what is the point? Integrity. The Holy Prophet establishes Islam on integrity. Integrity, akhlaq, positive behavior, seeing the cup as half full. If our children and we don't practice consistency, we lose efficacy. We lose integrity. Then, no matter what we say, people don't trust us. Let me give you the importance of integrity. Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He asks a man, he says, I would like to borrow some money for a short period of time, because Imam needed to do something. So the man looks at Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salam and says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, I trust you, but I want collateral. What's the collateral? What do you have to back up this large sum of loan? It was a large sum. Imam says, I don't have collateral. He says, I need collateral. He says, okay. You need collateral? He said, yes. Imam looks at a loose thread, you know, on his abba, and he pulls it. He wraps it. He says, here's my collateral. The man looks at this thing and he says, you would think you must be joking. Imam looks at him and says, what do you think? There's no collateral greater than Ahlul Bayt. Subhanallah. But look, he realizes, he looks at the hand, he says, you are the son of the Prophet, you're the Imam. How can I deny you? So he takes the thread, gives the sum. Then after a short while, Imam returns the money. He calls him, says, here's the money. So the man gladly takes it. Imam says, no, not yet. He's ready to leave. He says, my collateral. That's integrity. Do we have this quality? I tell you, in the annals of history, go and study the lifestyles of human beings, even great kings that came. Even Charlemagne, a great king who came, you can't even compare 1% with the footsteps of such personalities. That is why you and I should be crying the right tears. We should be saying, when Allah says, you see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِ أَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُ لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. Allah is talking to the Prophet. When my believers ask you about me, tell them I am near, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبُ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ. I reply them when they ask me. 100% Allah replies us. أَدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. 100% Allah replies us. 100%. Anybody doubts? If you and I doubted, then question the integrity of our existence. For there was nothing you and I did to exist. Look in the mirror and see the elegance of the creation of Allah. Every one of us here is beautiful. There's no ugliness in Allah's creation. No creature is ugly. Look at an insect. Look at even an atom. It's an elegant creation. Allah says, I made such elegance. I'll deny you the promise of prayer when I haven't denied an insect. It's guidance system, and you know how to get its food. How about you? When you and I doubt that, oh my God, we're in trouble. But look at the verse. He said, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُ لِي. Therefore, let them reply me. I love the second part. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that I have endowed you with too much intelligence. I have endowed you with too much abilities. Too many. What are you doing with it? Are you using it for me? Are you spending your money for me?
you're giving your life for me, the one who say قُلِنَ صَلَاتِي وَنُفُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. إِنَّ صَلَاتِي, my prayer, وَنُفُكِي, my sacrifice, وَمَحْيَايَ, my life, وَمَمَاتِي, my death, لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. For Allah, who can exemplify this on the highest platform than in Karbala? When people ask me about, just quick footnote, you know, you have 5 major schools of thought in Islam. Which one's right? 5. 5 schools of thought. Hanafi, Shafi, Maliki, Hanbali, among the Ahl-Sunnah. Then you have Ja'fari, Shia. I said, this argument was settled conspicuously and clearly in Karbala. You don't need to go far. The gray was sifted into black and white. You decide. This is why we're so blessed. You want to know history? Let me give a little history. You know what we have today that's happening? This is all the work of Muawiyah. Muawiyah bin Abu Sufyan. Mas'udi, a famous historian, states that after Muawiyah became Khalifa, this is leadership. I'm talking about leadership here. Shaitan wants to put his leader, and you and I have to establish the right leader. It's all about leadership. You get the wrong leader, even in a corporation, even in a team, get the wrong coach, you're not winning. You can be the best player, you will break apart. This is why leadership, when we talk about Ahlul Bayt, when we talk about Imams, when we talk about Prophets, when we talk about Shahadatain, as to why the Prophet is central, we say leadership. You take my leadership away, I've got no guidance system. I've got no role model. Mas'udi states that a man, his name was Mughira, goes to see Muawiyah after he became Khalifa. And he was a friend of Muawiyah. So he comes home, Mughira, very disappointed, very annoyed. His son says, Baba, why are you so annoyed? He said, I went to meet Muawiyah bin Abu Sufyan, and this man is a wretched man. He's mal'oon and mal'oon. Horrible man. This was his friend. The son asked him, why? He says, I went and I told him that, you know, now that you become Khalifa, why don't you back off on the Banu Hashim? Why don't you stop being jealous about them? Why don't you stop your venom against them? Why don't you stop the killing and all the fitna that you're creating against the family of the Prophet? This is authentic history, brothers and sisters. You want to hit a nerve? What I'm saying is the nerve. You don't have to go too far. You need to go into Hawza and study lots of stuff. You don't need to. It's too simple. So he says, what? Muawiyah says to him, what? I should back off? Are you kidding me? Muawiyah says. He says, what do you mean? He says, Abu Bakr, who was the companion of the Prophet, he did so much good. He died, no one talks about him. Bear in mind, Muawiyah now is the 5th Khalifa. So the period is very short. You're talking almost 50 years now. Just 50 years. Listen to what Muawiyah is saying. He's saying Abu Bakr was a good companion and nobody talks about him. He's vanished. Interesting. He said Umar bin Khattab was a very good companion. He did so much good for Islam. No one talks about him. This is from Muawiyah's mouth. He says Uthman bin Affan, he was a good companion. No one talks about him. But the brother of Hashim, his name is in the Adhan. And I will make sure I eradicate that. So what did he do? He brought the 3 back. And he made it his sunnah. That today all this chaos and crisis is the work of Muawiyah. If not for Muawiyah, all of this would have been vanished. Salat ala Muhammad wa al-Muhammad. He brought it back. He used to pay money and say, who can bring me a hadith that praises this Khalifa? And I will pay you gold. And he established thousands of hadith. Then when Bukhari and Muslims started collecting hadith, hundreds of thousands were collected as spurious, nonsensical, rubbish hadith. All at the cost of the treasury of the public that came from the cahoots of Muawiyah and his cronies. Today,
Shaitan tried very hard to kill and destroy the leadership so that Muslims should become like the other religions, where our books would be just carcasses and we wouldn't know where it came from and what is haq and what is batil. Whereas Allah says, قُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقِّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوكَ. This is why Karbala is so important. Having everything not gone and face this enemy face to face on a battlefield, and he was genius. Even Farazdak, he sees Imam Hussein leaving Mecca. He says, where are you going? He says, I'm going to Kufa. He says, their tongue is towards you, but their sword is towards your neck. They call you, but they will kill you. Imam says, I know. He says, the Ridham bi Qada. We are moving towards our Qada. We know why we're going. People are wondering. Even Muhammad bin Hanafiya says, my brother, where are you going? He says, you don't know. Only we know. We have been informed by the Prophet, informed by Allah, that we need to go on this altar of Adaynahu Bidhubhin Adeem. You want to seek clarity of leadership. That when the angels bowed, it was when Ibrahim was commanded, Inni Ara fil Manam, Adbahuka, this young child, magnificent Ismail, where Ibrahim had him when he was an old man. You ask any old man, when he has no son, and he has a child now, who's an elegant child, nothing is more precious to that father than that child. And Allah says, Adbahuka, I have been commanded to sacrifice you. Allah wants to show us. He says, you want to know my leaders? You want to know why he should be dhikr of them? These are not ordinary people that you can hold on to and be enamored by them when you go watch movies. And you think they are great stars and they know how to act and talk and they can be very eloquent and fluid on the pulpits. No! Allah says, no! Islam is a religion that's deep. It's pegged. It's really deep. You want to see how deep it is? So look at this young child being commanded as a prophet by a prophet that you will slaughter this child. Slaughter. This shatters the mind, the logic. How? Allah, you are merciful. Allah says, I am the most merciful. But how much faith do you have in me? But what I love is when Ismail hears his father talk. Allahu Akbar. I pray that every father should get a child, every mother should get a child like Ismail. This is the grandfather of Imam Hussein. You see? Why is Quran exemplifying this? You want to understand the entire Quran from cover to cover? It's all movements and momentums of prophets and Ahlul Bayt. Ahlul Bayt are walking, talking Quran. Walking, talking Quran. No question about. Walking, talking Quran. That's why we say they're infallible. They don't make a single mistake. Quran is infallible, they're infallible. Not one iota thereof. Every sentence, every walk. If you and I love Ahlul Bayt, you and I must love the Quran. You and I must talk it and walk it. So how does Ismail reply to his father? He says, If'al ma tu'mar. Do what you have been commanded. Satajiduni insha'Allah min as-sabirin. God willing, I will be seen, I will be considered among the patient one. Sabirin, this word, Allahu Akbar, it strikes me, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ista'inu bis-sabri was-salati innallaha ma'as-sabirin. All you believe, maintain, ista'inu bis-sabri was-salah, maintain patience and prayer. God is with the patient ones. Innallaha ma'as-sabirin. There's one thing to say, you and I, the good ones, are with Allah. There's a whole different movement when Allah says, I am with them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَا السَّابِرِينَ فَلَا تَقُولُ لِمَنْ يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٌ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Do not say, those who die in the way of Allah are dead. Nay, they're alive. You can't see that. لَا تَشْعُرُونَ وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُم مُّصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة وأولئك هم المهتدون. What an elegant set of verses. Allahu Akbar. Imam Hussein, all the Imams, but Imam Hussein alayhi salam lays it on the highest, highest altar of this verse. خوف جوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات. Nobody can exemplify this ayah in its fullest fruition than in Karbala. But when he even took the women, people are asking, why are you taking the women? You know they will kill you. Imam says, I have a mission. The women became the media. We'll talk about it tonight. How did the women maintain? Allahu Akbar, their hijab, their lack of it that was taken from them, them being taken prisoners. How about the children who were taken as orphans? You see, if Imam Hussein alone went to Karbala, just a quick analysis, and he was martyred, people might say, oh, he was hungry for power. He's a group of soldiers, they went to fight, they got killed. But there's a whole different dimension when you take your whole family, the precious ones, on the battlefield. You get the point? Look back in history, I'll tell you. When the Christians of Najran came, they debated the messenger about Tawheed. I want you to know, same thing, same, no change. When the Christians of Najran insisted that God has a son, Isa, a'udhu billah, Allah says to the messenger, invite them, nad'u abna'ana wa abna'akum wa nisa'ana wa nisa'akum wa anfusana wa anfusakum. This is in the Quran. Invite them. Now here's the talk is about Tawheed. Allah says, without the family of the Prophet, where is the Tawheed? Rasulullah is the front line of Tawheed, but without the family to be the guardian, to protect, to reflect, and to maintain the constancy, even the issue of Tawheed between Christians is nullified. That's why Allah uses Abna'na wa Abna'akum. Our sons, your sons, Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein were the only two sons the Prophet brought. Huh? The last, they said, the last of the Panjatan, the five, was Imam Hussein alayhi salam. That when he was martyred in Karbala, he's exemplifying that highest position that Allah says, Abna'na wa Abna'akum. Wa Nisa'na wa Nisa'akum. Our women, your women. There was only one woman, Fatimah al-Zahra, salamullahi alayha. One woman, and from her comes Zainab alayhi salam. From her comes Umm Kulthum. You look at such personalities that Zainab alayhi salam was a walking, talking Amir al-Mu'mineen as a woman. She was bold and intrepid, and I will describe a brief moment of how she speaks to Yazid and how she addresses him. He says, oh, ya yabn al-tulaqa, oh, you son of a freed slave. Why? Because Yazid, Muawiyah, and his father, Muawiyah and his father actually, both were prisoners. Because when Makkah was taken, they were both taken prisoner, and the Prophet released them. So they're known as freed prisoners. Tulaqa, meaning freed prisoners. Zainab alayhi salam is addressing him that way, with such boldness. She comes from this generation. And then the ayah says, Anfusana wa anfusakum, ourselves. Who is the self? They said only one man was behind the Holy Prophet, was Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. And Ibn al-Masih, Abdullah ibn al-Masih said, we swore that when we saw this family come in the morning, when we saw them, we saw light come out of their faces. And we knew that if they put their hands up, we would all perish and be destroyed. The line of Allah would be upon us and we would be destroyed. So you find the maintenance of this family. Imam Hussein alayhi salam is going to Karbala. Maintenance of deen through this pure family. You'll see the Quran is consistent that the entire prophetic mission is in one family. Why? You might ask why. People ask, why not Khalifa should come from the community, the Ummah? No. Integrity of maintaining the flag of Islam requires genealogy. Very important. Because credibility is built. We will ask, even if you find a very good person, you'll say, who's your father? Who's your grandfather? Where do you come from? You say, my grandfather was Ismail, who said to his father, do what you've been commanded. God will put me among the patient ones. That's your grandfather? He said, that's my grandfather. Subhanallah, integrity, isn't it? So now when you declare the authority, if you want to know when was the Prophet born, when did he die, what did he say, what was his sunnah, you go to the companions and ask, or will you ask the family first? Of course the family. No one knew the lifestyle of the Prophet more than the family. Qurba. Qurba. Qurba here are his blood. Lahmuhum lahmi wa damuhum dami. Ana harbun liman harabahum. I make war with them. This is the meaning. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So Imam Hussein alayhi salam, shahada,
in remembrance, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُ لِي, you and I need to reply. What happened? Why do we do Arba'een? There's a riwayat by Ibn Abbas, as well as by Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, where the Holy Prophet said, a believer is remembered by the angels for 40 days after their death. And they are maintained and remembered for 40 days. This 40-day period is the sunnah of Rasulullah. The Messenger mentioned it, and it was historical even prior to that. The 40-day period of what we call the importance of remembering personalities, particularly like Imam Hussein. But I want us to know, Arba'een is not the stop of the mention of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. In weddings, in any gathering, majlis of Imam Hussein should be constant. Constant. I can't stress it enough. Honestly, you might think, no, I'm being an extremist. You're a Shia. I said, no, no, no. It's not about being Shia. This is about haq versus batil. This is about the truth versus falsehood. Recite the nawhas. Recite the remembrance. Why? Look, I'll give you an example. As soon as they were released in Syria, what did they do? What did Zainab alayhi salam do? She took permission and said, give us a place. Give us a place. And the first majlis was in next to the palace of Yazid. First majlis of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And it continued. Even Imam Ridha alayhi salam, when he was the heir apparent to Ma'mun, he used to sit and bring the khatib and says, khatib, explain to them Karbala. So the khatib would start from the beginning all the way. All the way from Adam and continue all the way to Karbala. The imam would cry, the people would cry. The khatib is finished. After 1 hour, he said, khatib, start again. He said, I just finished. He said, start again. Let them know the importance of this message. This clarifies all ambiguities. Salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So Arba'een is very important, but I want us to stress that our actions and our performance is what counts. Our children today are indulging in drugs. The use of weed has become very prevalent. In our community in Michigan, 80% of the youth are smoking marijuana, which is weed. This substance is deadly. It causes psychosis. It alters the shape of the brain. It creates all kinds of dependencies. It's lethal. Please, let's not get fooled into thinking what's wrong with it. It's innocuous or it's medicinal. No, it's a controlled substance. Only physicians can administer it for certain diseases only. It should not be allowed. And you know, soon it's going to be legalized. And our kids will have access to it. And now this charcoal is getting hotter in our hand, to use the metaphor. So watch out. We need to encourage our children. When I see children smoking, I say, what are you doing? He said, I'm smoking. I said, why? Oh, what's wrong with it? I said, what's wrong with it? I ask you. I see kids holding argila, you know, this hookah. People who go and smoke shisha. I ask you a simple question tonight while we're going to cry for Imam Hussein. We're going to cry for Imam Zainul Abidin. For the horrible villain that was done, I want to ask us a profound question. Could you see them holding it? Forget about fatwas. Forget about its marja. We don't need it. Not this issue. This issue doesn't need it. I ask you, can you imagine Imam Sa'd al-Zaman alayhi salam holding it? I know some of you who do it don't like what I'm saying. It's fine. Hujjat tamam, as we say. Al-haqqu marru. Truth is very sour sometimes, isn't it? We need to say it. Because I care like I should care for my health. I know hubble bubble, which is the scientific term of argila, is poisonous. It destroys lives and it actually shatters the human body. In fact, it's more deleterious, more lethal than cigarettes. Why is Philip Morris and R.J. Reynolds paying for non-smoking campaigns, anti-smoking ads? Because America is a litigating society. You can be sued here. And they could bottom out if they have to pay everybody's cancer. What they did instead, they pretended on this side to be anti-smoking, but if you look at their records, their profits are on the increase. How? Because they went to third world countries that are not litigating and they have marketed heavily there. And in their minds they say they can all die and go to hell while we get rich. You and I are Muslims, upright. What does it mean, Hanifa, if it doesn't mean to be healthy, to eat good food, to eat halal food?
and not to eat haram food and to be healthy and to maintain a good body. There's hukukun nas. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam says, your skin has an argument against you on judgment day. Your body has an argument against you. Your eyes have an argument against you. Your tongue has an argument. What are you and I going to answer Allah when Allah says, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ? What are you going to answer? Stop it now. And don't say when Allah says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ. Hasten to forgiveness. This is what it means. Means Allah says, stop the bad. See, our children smoke this, you know why? Because we don't give them the message. You know why children don't want to smoke this thing? Because they have no vision. They don't know why they live. They have to live by the day. They need to get rich. You find people who got no homes, but they drive fancy cars in certain communities. Why? Because they have a status symbol. I had a mother who came to me and says, brother, I can't afford my child's school. I see her driving a brand new Range Rover. I said, sell that one. She says, never. I said, why not? She says, what will the community think? Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. See that? I looked at her and says, you need to come to school. We need to teach you. There's a serious problem here. You haven't captured life that you need to drive this fancy car? What happens? No vision. Vision is temporary. Show off. Let everybody say, wow, you're such a star. You feel good? Start the next cycle again. Go into the fat society and just keep getting this. But eventually the skin starts to sag and the wrinkles form and the body structure shrinks and the hair turns white. And then no matter how much light you put on your face, nobody just looks at you. And Allah is saying, get ready. Allah الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن ضَعْفٍ ثُمَّ جَعَلَ مِن بَعْدِ ضَعْفٍ قُوَّةٍ ثُمَّ جَعَلَ مِن بَعْدِ قُوَّةٍ ضَعْفًا وَشَيْبًا يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ. He creates you strong. He gets you weak. Then He makes you strong. Then He makes you weak and old. He creates as He wills. Allah says, take a lesson in this. Stop it. Be upright. This tragedy of Karbala is built on these principles. Principles of honesty, integrity, truthfulness. I swear, if we as a community stop being jealous on each other, not here, Ummah, jealousy. Karbala was about jealousy. Yusuf, in a world, jealousy, hasad. أَمْ يَحْسُدُونَ النَّاسَ عَلَى مَا أَتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلٍ. Are you jealous for what we're given? Instead of looking at the cup as half full and saying, Allah, you gave this one, give me also and give this person more. No. This is what Yazid was. Yazid, when he was hitting the lips of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, when he was playing with his lips, his blessed lips, it was jealousy, jealousy, ignorance, arrogance, jahiliyyah. So you and I have been given a template. The minute we have this, we are encroaching on the Umayyad principles. You and I say, God forbid, if I'm ever raised with that group, God forbid, I want to be raised with the Ahlul Bayt. Zainab alayhi salam now in Karbala is living, and we want to talk about Arba'een, because my time is up almost. I wish to conclude on this matter. And look, I can't stress enough, all these you and I will continue to recite. And mashallah, it's such a blessing that in America, Imam Hussein is being remembered. These black walls are in commemoration. While we walk around, we said, we're Husseinis. Mashallah, we should be the ultimate Husseinis. No question about it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold us liable. Please. This to me, I'm very worried. Why is our community getting lost? Why are our children getting lost? Why are such few participants in Islamic programs? We cry so much for Imam Hussein. Why doesn't it translate? The message is very clear. The atheists look at me and they said, your religion, is, you claim it's so perfect. How come your Muslims are like this? I said, the devil works the most with us. Because he knows where the truth is. So we are vigilant. And we know we're being pounded. But don't worry. We will win. And we will succeed. God has promised us that. This is what we're talking about. This victory. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, you know, when he was going to the battlefield, he recited this ayah. I love this ayah. You know, even as he's being martyred, he's reciting this ayah. Suratul Kahf. Some historians say that even after his death, they heard voices coming from his mouth. أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا. Have you not taken hisab of the youth of the cave and the inscription? It was an ajib situation. What Imam is saying, he says, this army is going to kill me.
But the ajaba is mine. My inscription will grow and my message will get so strong that they don't realize what I'm doing right now. But I've taken even my infant child to expose their animosity, that tomorrow no historian can dare say how wretched. In other words, they cannot argue how wretched the Umayyads were, that when Imam Hussein alayhi salam brings his little child forward, right, Ali al-Asghar, Abdullah, he says, what wrong has this child done? You are jealous of me. You're jealous of me. Well, what wrong has this child done? What wrong has this child done? And you find Hurmala replies him with an arrow, right? And while the Imam is talking to these people, giving them kind exhortations, وَدُوْ إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ, invite them with hikmah. Then while he's standing there, he says, okay, you have denied me water. You want to kill me. But what wrong is this child? Rabah, the mother, is watching from the tent. I think about how a mother like Rabah, what a woman she was. She was such a strong woman that she gave two of her children in Karbala. Two of them gave their lost souls, you know, the young boy. Abdullah, known as Abdullah Radi, known as Ali al-Asghar, and Ruqayya, known as Sakina, the one who died in Syria. This mother had to watch that. And Imam Hussain alayhi salam is teaching me, he said, Hassanin, look at me. I have stood firm against the wrong and the evil. You follow me. You will never give this sacrifice the way I have, but stand next to me. Remember me, do my zikr. Remember that I'm your template. I'm going to be with you in that world, in the next world, if you follow me and my principles. That while the Imam bring this baby, and they see the arrow lodged into his neck, into the arm of Imam Hussein. Imam takes the blood from this and he places it on his face. He looks up, he says, Ridham Nikaba, what is me? Oh Allah, we are satisfied by your decree and we bow to your command. We follow your command. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, as he was martyred, Imam Zainul Abidin witnesses this later on. He sees the crushed body of his father. He sees the head of his father on a spear. He was ill. He comes and he's standing on the by the chains and he's looking at these bodies. The head is missing. It's crushed. I can't imagine the vision of Zainul Abidin. Historians say whenever he was in Medina, he would pass by a butchery, he would look the other way. Whenever he would drink water, he says, As-salamu alaykum ya Abdullah Hussain. He says, I remember this past my father had. Imam Zainul Abidin now reaches Syria, and now he is in front of Yazid. And you find Yazid now wants to set a role model, an example. Historians say that first they went from Karbala to Kufa. Kufa, as you know, Ibn Ziyad was showing off how great a governor he was, started playing with the head of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, and Zainab gives the most profound arguments against him. He says, Ma ra'aytu illa jameelan wa rahma. I see nothing but beauty and mercy from God. Ibn Ziyad was stunned by that response, and quickly the people of Kufa started to rise, and immediately Ibn Ziyad sends an army and he moves the caravan of Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam and his family to Syria towards Yazid. When Imam Zainul Abidin arrives in Syria, you know, there were 7 adhans that were recited. 7. From the time they were, from the entrance of the gate to the time they met Yazid. 7 adhan. Yazid was drunk and he was just reciting foolish poetry. What a foolish man. And Shaitan says, this is my kind of leader. This is the one I want. But now Imam Zainul Abidin approaches. He enters. He comes in and the Syrians for the first time lay eyes on that flower, on the light of Islam. They were seeing the creature that represented Islam, the wretched creature Yazid. Now they're seeing a comparison next to each other. Imam Zainul Abidin with light in his face, the women coming with light in their faces. They're standing there in chains. And they're standing there and Yazid thinks he has now debased them. He thinks he has punished them. But look at the fury of Zainab alayhi salam. She replies him. She talks to him, says, Ya Ibnat Tanakaf. She answers this. It's a magnificent presentation. I don't have time. But she says, although calamities have forced me to speak to you, I nevertheless see you small in my eyes, and I find your verbal attacks great, and I regard your rebuke too much to bear. But these eyes are tearful, and chests are filled with depression. What is more strange is that the honored party of Allah is being killed by the taliq party of shaitan. You are killing us. You know, Imam Zainul Abidin was once walking outside Syria during this period, and a man says to him, so how have the people received you, O son of the Prophet? And Imam says, like the Bani Israel, who were under the tutelage of Fir'aun, where their men were killed and their children were made into orphans. He says, this is how we are being received. Imam Zainab is telling the Syrian, this is how we are being received. Zainab continues, he says, such hands are dripping with our blood, such mouths are feeding on our flesh, while those sacred and pure corpses are offered as food to the wild beasts of the desert and are dirtied by the brutes. Look at this comment, subhanAllah. He said, if you regard your wealth, you will soon find us as your opponents. That will be when you will find nothing but what your hands have committed, and your Lord never treats his servants unjustly. To Allah is my complaint, and upon him do I rely. So scheme whatever you wish to scheme. Carry out your plots, O Yazid. Intensify your efforts, for by Allah, you will never be able to obliterate our mention. Look at Zainab saying what? She says, you will never obliterate our mention. Today, millions of people are in Karbala. Millions, hundreds of millions are remembering Imam Hussein. ISIS and the Salafis can't sleep at night because the mention of Haq is being brought forward. And they can't sleep. And even the world, even mass media today, even modern media, CNN and Foxes, even these enemies of humanity, sometimes when they speak with nonsense that they do speak, even they acknowledge the events of Karbala in their messages. He says, we will not be obliterated. Nor will you ever be able to kill our inspiration. Nor will your shame ever be washed away. Your view shall be proven futile. Your days are numbered and your wealth is wasted on the day when Allah calls out. In other words, on the day of judgment, you will wish, because there was one man who was saying, oh, Amir al-Mu'mineen, calling Yazid, may your hands never be paralyzed. Zainab looks at him and says, shame on you. You say, may your hands never be paralyzed. She looks at Yazid and says, on judgment day, you will wish your hands were paralyzed after what Allah will do by burning your skin. He says, your view shall be proven futile. He says, the corner of Allah be upon the oppressors. All praise is due to Allah. The curse of Allah be upon the oppressors. All praise is due to Allah, who sealed the life of our early ones with happiness and forgiveness, and that of our last of martyrdom and mercy. This is Zainab, media. This is why Imam Hussein went to Karbala for this, took the women as media. Media, very, very powerful. Our women, if you see history, I'll talk about it tomorrow also in the afternoon, you will see when they reached Medina, what did the women do? But tonight suffice this important message of Karbala, of Arba'een. You find that Imam Zain al-Abidin then sees a man coming and praising Yazid. He's praising Amir al-Mu'mineen. What a great man you are. Imam looks at him and says, be quiet, you liar. Can you imagine? He's in chains. Yazid is sitting there ready to behead people. He has just killed. Imagine the strength. Allah said, رِجَالٌ لَا تُلْهِيهِمْ تِجَارَةٌ وَلَا بَيْعٌ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. They do tijarat only for Allah. They don't bargain for anyone. Imam Zain al-Abidin. He says, be quiet, you khatib. Silent. How dare you speak like this of Yazid? Then he looks at Yazid. He says, اِعْذَمْ لِي. Allow me to climb these a'wad. Imam Zain al-Abidin calls this pulpit pieces of wood. He says, allow me to climb up these pieces of wood. Look, why did he call it pieces of wood? Because the minbar wasn't being spoken with haq. So it became pieces of wood. When the minbar is spoken with haq, with Rasulullah, it becomes a minbar. So Yazid says, no, I will not let you. I will not allow you to climb up.
He says, let me speak so that there is barakah and there is blessing for the ummah. Look at the imam, how positive he's thinking. Let me go up there and tell them something. Yazid says, no.
He says, I know you, Banu Hashim, you Ahlul Bayt, you're very eloquent. Your grandfather Ali was very eloquent.
Scared. Imam waits, and the crowd in the court says, allow him, we want to hear him. We have not heard this man, let him speak. Yazid says, okay, but you will see. Imam Zain al-Abidin climbs up and he starts. They said the khutbah was so eloquent, was so elegant, that he starts, he says, those of you who know me, know me. Those of you who don't know me, let me tell you who I am. But before he starts, he praises Allah, the Holy Prophet, the Ahlul Bayt. He says, I bear witness, Day of Judgment is Haqq. Allah is Haqq. Imam Zain al-Abidin is teaching this crowd now. As he starts to speak, he says, Ana, who is Ana ibn Makkah? Well, Mina, I am the son of Makkah and Mina. Imam Zain al-Abidin continues to recite, and if I tell you the last pieces of what he said, Allahu Akbar, you will be stunned. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He ends, Imam, as he continues to speak, and he gives the entire history of Islam to tell the people who he is as the leader. He says, in the end, he says, I am the son of Fatimatu Zahra, salamullahi alayha. She is the Sayyidatun Nisa' al-Alameen. She is the leader of all the women. He says, I am the son of Fatimatu Zahra, the best of women. I am the son of Khadijat al-Kubra. People are listening. They knew Fatimatu Zahra. They knew Khadijat al-Kubra. Now they're realizing, putting the pieces of the puzzle together. Here the Imam starts to cry. He says, I am the son of the one who was slaughtered in Karbala. I am the son of the one who was lying in the desert. I am the son of the one whose head was cut off from its neck. I am the son of the one who was stripped of his turban and his robe. I am the son of the one who was thirsty until he died. I am the son of the one who was oppressed until he passed away. I am the son of the one whose head is on a spear and is being presented as a gift. He says, I am the son of the one whose women were taken as captives from Iraq to Syria. I am the son of the one upon whom the angels in the heavens wept. I am the son of the one whom the jinns on earth wailed and the birds in the skies cried. He continues to identify himself. Yazid sees people are crying. In the crowd, the people started to cry. And as they're crying, Yazid realizes, oh my God, everything I've done is being dismantled by this one presentation. So Yazid looks at the Khatib and the Muazzin and says, recite my Quran. It wasn't prayer. He says, recite it. I want to stop this guy from talking. So the Muazzin starts. He says, Allahu Akbar. Imam Zain al-Abidin stops, he says, Jalla Jalalahu Rabbi, mighty is Lord, mighty is Allah. He says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Imam Zain al-Abidin says, Ashhadu an la ilaha, no doubt. Then when he says, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, Imam Zain al-Abidin says, stop! He says to the Khatib, stop! Imam Zain al-Abidin looks at Yazid and says, is that your grandfather? No. That is my grandfather. You are reciting our Quran. Oh my grandfather. How dare you kill us, oh Yazid. Yazid puts his head down and says, without a doubt, his mother, I cannot speak bad about her. Yazid says that. Imam Zain al-Abidin says, oh people, what have you done? How have you allowed this tyrant to remain in power? Don't you realize your obligation is to obey ati Allah, ati Rasul, wa uli al-amri minkum? So Yazid quickly, as you know, puts them into prison. And then the little Ruqayya, as you know, used to cry every night. This little girl crying on her father's chest. And Rabah, she's caressing her daughter. The daughter says, I want my father. Yazid gives her his hand, the hand of Imam Hussein. They say Ruqayya holds this hand. She caresses it. She cries. She talks to her father.
And then she stops breathing. And she's buried inside that same prison. So then, as you know, within a short time after that, Yazid decides to release them. When he releases Zainab and Imam Zainul Abidin, Imam says, give me all our belongings. This is why Arba'een is so important, because Arba'een's importance is that the head of Imam Hussein was put together with the body of Imam Hussein. This is why it's important. The head came together and it was placed in its proper place, because Imam Hussein alayhi salam did not get that opportunity. So you find that then the head was given. Now I want you to imagine for a moment Zainab alayhi salam looking at this head. They say, give us the family ones. He says, the Banu Hashim heads were given. The head of Aun and Muhammad comes to Zainab. My brothers and sisters, I want you to imagine. Then Zainab alayhi salam says, this beautiful two heads being brought. She's the mother of these two sons, Aun and Muhammad. And Ali Akbar's head is brought. Abbas's head is brought. I want you to understand that while these heads are being brought to them, how is our Imam seeing it? My God, this trial is unbearable. Unbearable. He says, the Imam Zainul takes all of these heads, puts them together, and they remain for a short while in Syria, and the majlises start, and they say that when the Khatib is reciting what happened in Karbala, Zainab was standing outside welcoming people. This was the akhlaq of Zainab's majlis, that she would stand outside welcoming people. Come and listen to this story. This is how important it is. So then they travel towards Karbala, and they say as they arrived at Karbala, they noticed a great companion of the Prophet waiting. They said, Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari, who was the oldest companion of the Holy Prophet, who told him, there will come a time you will see my great-great-grandson, Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salam, who is going to be the fifth of the Imam, kiss him lip to lip from me when you see him. Jabir bin Abdullah was blind. He took his relative Atiyah, he took her with him, and she directed him to where Karbala was on the 40th. Jabir is standing by the graces. Assalamu alaikum, ya ayyuha shuhada. He looks at the grave of Imam Hussein. He sees this sign there. He looks and is now looking. He's asking salam. He says, salam, where are you? He says, I have come to visit you, Jabir. They say, Jabir prayed to rak'a salam, ziyara. And he waited. Then he sees this kafila coming. Allahu Akbar. I just want you to imagine, for the first time after the imprisonment, Imam Zainul Abidin, Zainab alayhi salam, the women, they're coming back now, and the first place, they didn't even go to Medina, they first come to Karbala to pay visit to Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the ziyara of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. They say that Imam Zainul Abidin, as he's approaching Jabir bin Abdullah, you could see that Jabir started to cry. He looks at Imam Zainul Abidin and he hugs him, and he sees the pain on Imam Zainul Abidin. They say that there was so much pain in his body that his chains, even when he was held in chains, he was scarred, that even the chains scarred his wrist. Imam Zainul Abidin was scarred with the wrist, and Jabir sees this and he acknowledges this, and then he welcomes them. And this is where Imam Zainul Abidin starts to cry. I just want you to remember that when he comes back to Karbala, how he remains there and he buries the head, and he buries the head of all the Banu Hashim, because the other heads were left behind in Syria. In conclusion, you find all the women, Zainab included, they leave towards Medina. One woman remains behind. She was Rabab, the wife of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. This woman who gave two children in Karbala, Ali Asghar and Ruqayya, she says, I don't want to go back to Medina. I want to stay here. So they asked her, why? She says, I want to welcome the caravan so that I can teach them what happened here. So they say she pitched a tent. I look at this woman, I said, what an honored woman. She's like Hajar of Ibrahim. They say she remained in the area and she had water next to her. She said, when a caravan comes, I want to feed them water in the name of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Sabeel of Hussein alayhi salam. They say she remained in Karbala until she breathed her last and she is buried in Karbala. Ala la'natullah al-qawm al-zalimin. Wa sa'alamu al-ladhina zalamu ayyamun qalabin yanqalibun matami Hussein.
عمر ابو الاساس ولا الله شمر ولا الله امه اسرجت والجمت وتنقبت لقتال بابي انت بامي لقد عظم مصابيبك فاسال الله الذي اكرم مقامك واكرمني